The Vietnam War, it's over. Your job's just begun.
A new HBO original limited series.
Welcome to the world of spycraft.
Strap in.
From executive producers Park Chan-wook and Robert Downey Jr.
What are you concealing?
Based on the Pulitzer Prize-winning novel by Viet Thanh Nguyen.
What if I told you that I was a communist spy?
How did you become this?
The Sympathizer, streaming April 14th on Max. Subscription required.
Age of Radio.
Hey, everybody, this is Steve. I just want to let you know that for all the latest on our podcast, hit us up at EILF Movies. That's Everything I Learned from Movies on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. We're also on Patreon if you want to check that out. But our homepage is with the Age of Radio Network at ageofradio.org/everythingilearnedfrommovies. And if you're looking for some amazing art, check out my wife's Etsy page at untidyvenus.etsy.com. All kinds of great stuff there. Also, follow us at PodcartFest, that's PodcartFest, for our periodic art and podcasting festival that we're going to be hosting. It's actually pretty cool. Check it out. So yeah, on that note, let's get to the show.
Everything I learned from movies helps to make life a little bit groovy. We're the one last plot holes of gratuitous movies. It's time to get busy with your friend Steve and Izzy.
From the creators of Air Bud and Most Valuable Primate, and only on DVD. In a time when evil forces threaten our existence.
Your invention will make me the greatest scientist of the millennium.
And the world is on the brink of disaster.
That's not what I invented it for. It's supposed to help people.
There's only one secret agent who can save the day. Move over, James Bond. Move over, Austin Powers. The world of intelligence discovers a new breed of secret agent.
It's that darn Moki. He's on the train.
Somebody get rid of that flying monkey.
Thought you could use some kick butt assistance.
Let's rock and roll.
Spymate, now available on DVD.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Steve.
And I'm Izzy.
And this is Everything I Learned from Movies. And tonight.
Oh, tonight.
We are continuing April.
Woo!
With 2003's question mark, Spymate.
Woohoo!
Oh, but babe.
Steve.
We're alone for this one. But,
oh, thank God.
Do you remember your first time watching this movie?
This was my first time watching
this
movie.
This was also my first time watching this movie. You remember first time hearing about this movie?
No.
Gosh, it was probably a couple years ago. We definitely knew it was a thing after we did MVP, Most Valuable Prey,
yes, okay.
Or whatever.
Yeah.
And we were like going through. We knew there was the Spy Monkey movie out there because Spy Hards, mm-hmm, and all that. We brought it up to them and they're like, oh yeah, everybody wants us to do that one. But guys, we're doing it first. So
we're popping the cherry on this. Are we supposed to be peeking that much?
Apparently we just are, so I'll just fix it in post or something.
I'm used to it just barely looking like a mumble.
Yeah, I know.
So.
Yeah, I don't know what's going on with it. But babe.
Steve.
I don't know about you. I'm a little thirsty.
Oh, that's weird. I'm sober.
Oh, well, let's see what we got here. From Ketos Brewing in Salt Lake City, Utah, we have their Finnish Olut Lager, O-L-U-T, Lager. Let's see. Yeah, you know, Ketos means thanks in Finnish and blah, 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 blah. We actually were just at Ketos.
We got this direct from the brewery.
Yeah, we were out there doing the homebrew ta beer judging competition for homebrew here in Utah.
The and dark lagers.
The dark lagers. Specifically beers we enjoy.
Yeah. Oh, God, though. How come I always get picked for sours?
I don't
know.
Like,
do they just have it down now after I did the sours and fruited lambics that one year that, like, that's my expertise?
Yeah, it's on your profile.
Is that it?
This girl described something as a horse blanket and Barbie purse or whatever. So
yeah, I
she knows
literally
what she's
wrote
about.
Down one that it tastes like the inside of Barbie's purse. I was told that while that may not be super professional, it was 100% accurate. I also described one as tasting like the inside of a garbage disposal. Actually, I described like three of them. And the other judges thought I was being quite harsh until they tasted the beer.
That makes sense. So why don't we test this beer?
Oh, not fruited. See if not this alambic, a loot lager
is a loot of bullshit. My top?
Ah! His top!
Nice. Oh, yeah. 5% alcohol by volume, of course. And the pour?
We'll just be a fucking sour. Ooh, it's a beautiful golden beverage. Has a white creamy head with a pretty medium-sized bubbles that appear to be dissipating pretty quickly.
Medium-sized bubbles dissipating quickly. Yeah. Oh.
Is this it like smells the... like a Cali Common. Like, it almost smells, right? Like sort of rye-ish?
Yeah, I was thinking that it might be like one of them, the like spruce tip kind of beers or whatever.
Oh, wait. There's definitely like an adjunct in here, right? How do you spell O-L-U-T?
O-L-U-T. Yeah, there's a little... Yeah, it's like a little sweetness, kind of like a, God, I don't know what flavor that would be. It's piney. I don't know if it's the hops coming through with it, but there's, like, if you told me it was like a little bit of peach or something on here, like it's not super strong by any means.
Yeah, there's something giving it a tangy.
Weird.
Let's see. The Finnish Olut lager from Kitos is an American style lager. A lot of people are saying they're getting a lot of sweetness and honey. I'm not getting sweetness and honey.
I mean, maybe honey, but yeah, definitely whatever it is, it's sweet and a little kind of like earthy aromatic. But like it might be honey, but I don't know what Malute Lager means.
Let's see, that just seems to be their name of it. What does loot mean?
Does it mean a bunch of twisted snakes? Because that's apparently the front of the logo here. Not completely unpleasant or anything, but yeah, just not my bag.
Alu means, like, standing out, highly expressive, very sociable, basically like social butterfly.
Oh.
So this is the social lager.
Oh, okay. Cool. Yeah, it's all right. Like
that's
that
one
little...
way it's a group of snakes, because they're all being social, babe.
Yeah, they're all intertwined. They're just mingling the shit out of each
other.
Yeah,
there's definitely like a sourness to it. Yeah, like, or an acidity.
It's almost like the green apple, but it's not quite as sharp as that.
Yeah, it's not acetaldehyde. It's something.
Something a little perfumey, I guess. But yeah, not terrible by any means. Just, I don't know, after like a pint or two of it, I'd be like, what else you got? That's Kitos Finnish Olut Lager. Kitos usually makes some great stuff, so if you see them, try them out.
Okay, apparently it does have honey in it, so that might be where we're getting that sharpness.
Oh, okay. Yeah, it explains like the earthy notes and stuff too. Alright. Anyway, Spymate.
Spymate!
From writer-director Robert Vince.
Who's he, Steve?
Oh, I'm glad you asked. You might know him as a producer of Just One of the Girls, Breaking Point, Malicious, Crash, yes, the 1995 one that you love.
Which Crash, Steve? Which Crash?
The car sex one, you know.
Oh, the only one I've seen.
Yeah, Underworld, Air Bud Golden Retriever. Then he started directing and producing with one of our favorites, MVP Most Valuable Primate, MVP2 Most Vertical Primate,
yeah.
Air Bud Seventh Inning Fetch, this Most Extreme Primate, Air Buddies, Snow Buddies, Space Buddies, Santa Buddies, Spooky Buddies, Treasure Buddies, Santa Paws 2, The Santa Pups.
Fuck this guy.
Super Buddies, Monkey Up, Pup Star Better Together. Pup Star: Better Together.
Oh, goddamn.
Because it's the second one, get it? Pup Star World Tour, Pup Star Christmas, 6 episodes of Pup Academy, 8 of Super Pup Z, and Phantom Pups. But babe, there were other writers on this as well.
Oh, thank God.
First up, Anne Vince. Huh, they have the same last name. I wonder why that would be. She also wrote MVP, MVP 2, Air Bud 7th Inning Fetch, and this.
7th Inning Fetch.
There's also Anna McRoberts. Who's she? All the Air Bud movies, all the pups, and all the primates. And written by Ed McRoberts. Wow, they have the same last name too. I wonder if they're related. This is his only writing credit, though.
So, okay.
I'm sure they're all in a meeting talking about, all right, how are we going to exploit this golden retriever and chimpanzee franchise into another thing? And someone's like, why don't you make a Bond movie with a chimp? God damn it. Ed, you got yourself a goddamn writing credit, my friend. Oh, but starring in this movie, my love, this is a star-studded movie. Of course, we have Louie as Minky. Yes, the chimp, the star, the spy mate, if you will.
Yeah,
you
okay? Minky.
Oh,
yeah. No, it's good.
All right. We have, let's see, who else we got in here you might know. Richard Kind as Dr. Farley.
Who's he, Steve?
You know him, fuck. he pops up in everything. Whenever you think somebody's Kurt Fuller and it's not, it's him.
Okay.
I don't know. Sorry about it. Jay Brazier as Ringmaster. Don't even ask. Emma Roberts. That's right. Young offspring of Eric Roberts, Emma. As Amelia. I think she's, what, like 10, 11 years old, something like that?
Yeah, something like that.
We have Pat Morita as Kiro.
What? Debra... Mr. Miyagi?
That's right, Mr. Miyagi himself.
Who?
Right. Debra Jo Rupp as Edith. Who's she? She's the mom from that 70s show.
Yeah, she's funny as hell.
Musetta Vander as Dr. Amor.
Musetta
Vander. Yes, you might know her as Sindel from Mortal Kombat Annihilation. Fuck dog. I'm so glad you're awake.
He woke up just for this.
Like,
Steve.
In general. I know. I told you exactly what the fuck he was going to do.
Asleep for hours. I know you want to take your bone outside.
All right, I'm going to chug a lot of this beer.
It'll help your attitude. Come on, Sush. You ring the bell. All right? Fuck you. I want to do what you tell me.
Yeah, throw that bell outside. Barry Bostwick as the president.
Who?
Megaforce.
Yeah.
And FDR American Badass.
Yes.
It's a movie. Look it up.
Yeah.
And of course, friend of the podcast, Michael Bailey Smith.
Oh my God, who's he, Steve?
You might know him as the Thing from the best Fantastic Four movie out there.
Yeah.
He pops up in everything. Monster Man or whatever? The one where he drives the monster truck and it's like
Monster
trying to
Trucks.
No. The horror version, Monster.
Oh,
I think it's called Monster Man. Guys, it's a horrible fucking movie. Please don't watch it. He's great in it, but
he's not the problem with that movie.
Yeah, yeah, it's the other 85 minutes of screen time. But yeah, he's in this movie as Hugo. Hugo Stieglitz. No, they give him a different last name. But, yeah. So guys, you may be wondering, where can I find this? I have to watch this now. Get it in me. Babe, how did we watch this?
Did we own it?
We own this movie.
Yes!
It came in, it came in like an 8-pack of family movies or whatever we got for like $2. And, the other three movies on this disc... That's right. This entire movie is a quarter of a DVD.
Yeah.
Well,
DVD technology has come so far.
I guess. But the other three movies are Gordy. Yes, maybe coming soon.
Yes.
Dark Horse, which I assume is like War Horse, only darker.
Yeah.
And Two Bits and Pepper.
Two Bits and Pepper!
I think it's a family horse movie from what it looks like. I don't know. But, guys, if you don't own this on DVD, first off, what's wrong with you? No, it's on YouTube. You can also pay $4 on Amazon and stuff, but yeah, we'll see if it's worth it. If it's worth it. Sorry, can't talk. But, babe, do you remember how this movie starts out?
Oh, there's a guy tied to a chair. No? Did we not cold open?
Nope.
Nope, then I don't remember how this opened.
So we start off looking over... The desert land of Arrakis. I know.
Oh my god, that's right. Lawrence of ArAPEia.
Lawrence of ArAPEia. As we have written down. We see the dunes and a little Bedouin dressed monkey walking through the hills. You know, the triumphant Charles Band version of Lawrence of ArAPEia theme starts playing. It's great, guys. And it says the Arabian Desert or whatever, 1994. And I'm like, all right, a scant 30 years ago. Got it.
Oh, Steve, so I have something terrible to tell you about the apes in this movie.
Oh, no. Oh, no. Are they already retired?
They are retired.
Okay. But yeah, he's wandering around. He comes up to this this camp of tents and just starts sneaking around. And he hops up on the roof of one of them. And he looks down in the top, I don't know, air flap or whatever. And he sees some white guy all tied up in the middle. This must be his target. And he jumps down in there and, you know, takes the gag out or whatever. The guy's like, you better hurry. What's his name? Minky. Yeah. You better hurry, Minky. There's only 3 minutes until this missile's going to shoot that and be blasted at that peace summit. But then, like, one of the guards comes in and is like, "Oh, rock, rock, Dirk, Dirk, Allah," or whatever. And so we get a monkey pulling not only a sword, but an extendable sword that he, like, whips out and it, like, doubles in size. And we get a monkey fucking sword fight. And, yeah, like, doing backflips and, like, the sword breaks in half, but then he still, like, sticks him in the butt or whatever and starts swinging haymakers and shit. It's fantastic, guys. Like, it's... and, you know, he, like, unties the guy afterwards, like, "Thanks, Minky, we gotta get out of here." And, oh, but remember, we gotta take the detonator out of this missile. And so they do that. All the other guards come running in, la 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 la, and they, I don't know, throw a little grenade in there. And then they just drive off on a four-wheeler while they're being chased by guys on horseback. And then we just cut to them on a power glider, yeah, like a little power glider, like a goddamn gyrocopter, just about.
Oh,
and
yeah.
And just flying off. And then
it's like
we see
the collapsible one from one of the James Bonds. Sean Connery one.
Yeah, little Charlie or whatever the fuck they call
it. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, but yeah, they're flying off of one of those, and you see in the background the camp just starts exploding, like, blah, 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 blah. Oh, that's right, the missile went off. But, it, like, just exploded and go flying off, and it's like, yeah, cold open, baby. And yeah, as they're, like, flying away or whatever, you know, this guy, by the way, the dad in this, I forget the actor's name, but babe, from the beginning, what did I say? This guy looks like the dad from The Pacifier.
Yes.
Looked it up.
Yes.
It's the dad from The Pacifier. Exact same situation.
Yeah.
Like apparently Spymate was what he did while he was kidnapped or something. Because I think they came out the same year, like 2003, 2004. Oh, that's fantastic. But he's basically like, "Good job, Minky, man. I think it's time for us to retire. We're getting too old for this shit. I got a daughter to raise." Yeah. And then we see the mom from the 70s show for like 3 seconds.
She's just sort of like, "They're the best in the business."
Yep. Cut to 10 years later.
Years later.
Yep. And then we see young Emma Roberts. Her name's Amelia in this movie, and she's on the computer just, I don't know, hacking away or whatever, blah, blah, blah. Oh, that's right.
She's invented a chemical drill laser.
Yeah.
And she's getting ready to present it for the science fair, but then also to elite scientists?
Yeah. Well, I think she had won, like, the national award, and this was, like, the award ceremony she was going to. But I like how her dad's like, "That's great, sweetie. Are you ready for the national they said it weird. It was like, the National Scientific Awards. And I'm like, is that... All right, we'll go with it. But
yeah,
and he's like, "Hey, remember how I told you I used to be a spy and my partner
dad,
was a monkey?"
You're such a liar.
Like, I don't believe that, Dad.
Like, nobody believes you.
And honestly, I'd be like, "Yeah, show proof." It's like, I'd love to tell you more, but then I'd have to kill you. But, yeah, I don't know. Yeah, she's going off to school or something. Like she's going to school because, you know, that night's the awards thing. She doesn't have to, like, take the day off or whatever, right? And someone's just, like, spying on her, like, from across the street. You can't quite see who it is. So then we cut to a circus. I feel like...
The circus did not need to be in this movie, by the way.
What else do you think Minky would have been doing as a retired spy mate?
I obviously living in a penthouse full of whores.
You sweet monkey horse.
Sweet monkey horse. Could have had like another chimpanzee in like a little flapper dress. Like, come on, Steve. Little negligee. Smoking one of the cigarette like extender things.
Yeah, yeah, the cigarellos or whatever.
Yeah, like, oh, what was the movie we did last April with the two apes the lady raised as her children?
Oh, shit. yeah, Buddy. Buddy, Buddy.
Yeah, Buddy. Yeah.
You have to go the way that every retired spy does. Yeah. You have to retire to southern Thailand, a nice little bar set up.
Get drunk.
I don't know, maybe an Academy Award winning actress is running it.
Right?
That's Mechanic Resurrection. Check it out, guys.
Honestly, it's probably one of my favorite openings of almost any movie.
Fuck yeah, dude. Now picture Jason Statham in that. Oh my god, that movie makes so much more sense if Jason Statham is replaced with a chimpanzee. I mean, the pool scene? And if Tommy Lee Jones is an orangutan or something? I don't know. It's like, no, Tommy Lee Jones will be exactly the same. Exact same performance, I'm sure, too.
I don't know. I feel like you still need some Jason Statham. Maybe if he's just partnered with an ape.
Oh, yeah. That's the sequel to Spy. I ever tell you about how I was partnered with a chimpanzee? I learned everything I know from him. So we're at this circus and there's like these black and white French clowns, and I don't know, there's like a lady who rolls down the hill like the human bowling ball. Like, you guys have seen Hook, right? Like, what's his name? Thunderbutt or whatever. Rolls down the... I don't know. There's another guy doing like a tug of war with a tractor. There's a guy running around like fucking Quicksilver. Like, oh, he's the fastest guy in the world. Ooh, his name's Lightning or some shit.
Woo! Yeah, it's the Fantastic Four.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. Yeah, it's all the superheroes you need, right? There's even the guy on the trapeze. But guys, the star of the show, Minky on a motherfucking jetpack. Yeah, he even does a little trapeze and stuff too. I don't know, editing some shit. I don't know. Oh, that's right. No, the trapeze guy, like the line snaps or whatever, and starts falling, and that's when Minky on the jetpack to the rescue, and everybody on it says like, "Oh, oh my god, he did it!" So then we cut to Amelia. It's the award show. She's being presented. You know, like, congratulations, if you could just do a quick demonstration of this laser drill that you did. And I'm like, oh my god, it's the laser drill from the core. Guys, it's even worse. We can look closer. But, yeah, we're also introduced to Dr. Farley, who's played by Richard Kind. He's, like, from the beginning, obviously, the bad guy of the show. Like, guys, this is like a PG movie. There's no real surprises or anything, other than maybe my reaction to how... this may be the greatest movie ever. I don't know. We'll find out.
This might be Steve's new favorite movie of all time.
Yeah. We'll see. We'll see. But, yeah, so the thing is, like, she's given this demonstration. She was like, oh, yeah, using this recycled hydrogen, blah, 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 like, basically taking air and turning it into a laser beam. This will put an end to drilling. And I'm like, what exactly do you think you're doing? Yeah, but the other thing about this drill is like, oh yeah, and the only byproduct is it releases oxygen into the air. And I'm like, bullshit.
Yeah, it's a chemical drill. It's fracking. Yeah. This girl just invented fracking with extra steps.
Exactly. But it put an end to drilling. Yeah, sure.
No, it will double down on drilling.
Yeah. Welcome to the Hollow Earth, everybody.
And then does she program it to see nothing?
Oh, god damn it. Not a stupid machine. Anyway. So, oh, and Dr. Farley, for whatever reason, like scans her face or whatever, too. Like, oh, yeah, it's just for, like, your ID badge or whatever. I don't know. Oh, no, scans the dad's face, too.
That's right. That's right. Yes. Scans
both of them. But, yeah, we cut to the morning, and I don't know. He like, shows up at Amelia's house for, like, a limousine pickup. Well, let's see. No, that's right. Okay, so Dr. Farley's, like, picking her up in a limo because said, I think he tells the dad, like, oh, yeah, I'm going to take her to my my building in downtown. She's going to help us with a project. And, you know, we're going to collaborate a little more and blah, blah, blah.
We're working on building a life-size version of her laser, and she's going to get to meet Dr. Amour.
Ooh, Dr. Amour. I've heard such great things about her. But then he's like, oh, yeah, surprise. Anyway, we're going to Japan to do this to make the full sky drill.
I don't know. I should talk to my dad.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Let me get him on the phone right here or whatever. Or that's right. Get him on the phone when we get to the airport. And then, we see, like, super deep fake dad or whatever.
Super deep fake dad.
Like, hey, sweetie. Yeah, that sounds great. Let's do that. Yeah, good. I hope you have fun on your trip to Japan. And she's like, I don't know, Dad. I don't know about this. Like, well, I gotta go, sweetie. Bye. Fucking great. But yeah, this is about the time a friend of the podcast, Michael Bailey Smith, shows up as Hugo. He's basically, you know, being a giant dude that he is.
Yeah.
He's tall. I don't know if they were, like, purposely making him pasty or whatever, but he's got, like, the scar on his eye.
Oh, they purposefully are making him. Yeah, he's, like, an albino, and he's got, like, one blue eye and one green eye. And
yeah.
It's weird. Yeah.
It's all the Bond trope, Bond villain tropes in one. I don't know. Kind of great. But, they like, hop on, like, a fucking hydrofoil or whatever. Like, yeah, this will take us to Japan. And I'm like,
oh, yeah
in the next 4 or 5 days, totally.
Oh, no, this is the fastest way to get you to Japan. It'll get us there, what was it, like, 4 hours or something?
Yeah. Like, oh, cool, you're going 600 miles an hour. Maybe faster? I don't know, but whatever. And around this time, Dad, he's back home, and he's like, man, I'm so proud of my daughter, dee-dee-dee-dee. Oh, look, I got a package! Opens up, there's a little video player inside, and it's basically Dr. Farley being like, hey, we have your daughter. Don't call the cops. You'll get her back in a week. We're just gonna, you know, she's gonna help us, like, take over the world or whatever with her laser drill. Bye! Yeah, I don't know. So, basically shit like that. But yeah, basically, like, don't worry, you'll have her back in a week. Yeah, we kidnapped her. No, big whoop. You'll never find us. That kind of shit. Oh, and then it self-destructs, too, so we, you know, can't be like, look, this guy obviously kidnapped my daughter. I don't know.
Yeah, there's always that trope.
But, of course, the dad's like, well, looks like I'm back in the spy business. And then he hops in a motherfucking DeLorean and drives off, and I'm like, oh, my God, this movie is turning great every scene. And he goes and picks up Minky and, like, basically fills him in, like, hey, guys. Hey, Minky, my daughter's been kidnapped. Can you help me out? Here, we'll have martinis and shit. It'll be great. I don't know. I'm like, yes, monkey with a martini. Let's do it.
Monkey with a martini!
And they also go and talk to 70s mom, Debbie Jo Rupp. I forget what her name is in this. Edith, that's right. I guess Edith was like his money penny back when he was a spy, or I guess they were spies.
Yeah.
And so she's like, yeah, we're back in the game. Now you gotta
we're back in the game.
Get back in my outfit.
Oh, yeah, she squeezes into, like, like a leather skirt and leather top.
Yeah.
There's a montage.
Oh, and also because he's picking him up, picking Minky up at the circus, all the circus friends or whatever want to join in, too, and help out. So they come along for the ride, too. Yay! And as I've written down, I'm fucking in!
Yeah! Heaps, 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 heaps.
And then, yeah, Edith starts going through, like, all the new gadgets, like, you know, the laser pen, the x-ray goggles, apparently, like, an electro paintball gun.
Yeah!
And I'm like, oh, wow, the PG gun, got it. And they're like, oh, man, we don't even know where to start. We don't know where they're headed off to. Well, we know Dr. Amour is in Jamaica. Maybe we should go there.
To Jamaica!
Okay, to Jamaica! And then, oh, that's right. And around this time, Edith also gives the backstory about Project Spymate. Babe, do you remember about Project Spymate?
Yeah, they were trying to combine all the best qualities of an ape and a spy. But the apes kept failing tests, all of them, except for one, Minky.
Yeah. And then, but because it cost so much or whatever, they were told to dispose of them. And it was up to the dad or whatever.
He was put in cold storage. They put him in storage. They put Minky in storage, and then the dad found him in storage. and yeah, because it was there was like the shot of him in like a box.
Oh no, shit! I thought they were.
Yeah, I didn't see that part. They put him in storage. You might have been just looking down. It was like a quick flash of you know, like those metal like.
So wait, were they doing it like in the 60s or something in kind of out of cold storage?
It wasn't like frozen. I said cold storage. I didn't mean that. Like it was just like he was in a box, like just like in storage.
You just put away like top men or whatever.
Yeah.
And like, oh, they're sick of feeding them, so take them out and dispose of them. But then
there was a break in, or there was something happened.
The Russians were trying to get a hold of Minky because they were doing their own primate program or some shit. But Minky saves them by whooping a bunch of Russians' asses, and then and then they decided to keep him on as the partner in whatever spy unit they were a part of, and they've been partners ever since until they retired. So then we cut to Jamaica, and they check in at the hotel, and we see that, you know, Hugo, big-ass Michael Bailey Smith, is following him. And being the smoothest spies not named James Bond, they're, like, asking the front desk clerk, like, hey, is Dr. Amore here? They're like, I'm sorry, I can't tell you that. What about my friend George Washington here? You know, like, do you have a couple other friends named George Washington? I don't know, whatever, but... But eventually, like, oh, yeah, she's at the beach. So, yeah, we go and meet Dr. Amore. We get the total, like, Bond girl entrance where she's coming up out of the water. And then, I don't know. Basically, from there, it kind of goes between this and the whole Japan thing or whatever. So I'm just kind of...
Yeah, anyway, like, basically, they convince her we should go to Japan.
Yeah. She's, like, asking, like, hey, what do you know about Dr. Farley and this, you know, trying to steal my daughter's laser drill and kidnapping her? Like, what? Oh, no, he's crazy. He always talked about doing it, but I never thought he actually would. That's why I left. And I'm like, well, that doesn't make sense, because if you didn't think he was going to do something, that's why you left, were you planning on eventually doing it yourself? Don't worry about it.
Babe, we don't want to talk about her Jamaican drill that's going on right now. That's for Spymates, too.
That's right.
Dr. Amore, we never thought you would turn on us like this. I had to delete the competition.
That's right.
Look into my
brain. He was going to go down the volcano. I was going to go down the Gulf of Mexico.
What accent is that, Steve?
I don't fucking know.
I think it's the talking hand from South Park.
Yeah. I'm Jennifer Lopez. Oh, Ben, you are so perfect. You're spectacular in every way. You almost make me forget about tacos. Taco flavor keys in the room.
And scene. All right. So what happened? Oh, yeah. Meanwhile, in Japan, we see Pyramid Enterprises or whatever, you know, Farley's company. I don't know. Hugo's like checking in and is basically giving an update of like, hey, you know, the dad, he's found Dr. Amore. And I think or like he's starting to give him an update. But then we see Minky just clock him in the head with a fucking coconut.
Yeah.
And I love how Dr. Farley's just like, hello? Hello? Ah, it must be a bad connection. Like, I don't know. But yeah, so, oh, okay. And then because Hugo got clocked with a coconut, he's got some massive CTE going on. Babe, what happens? He gets knocked out.
Oh, he sees a talking monkey.
That's right. Minky's in front and he goes, hey, man, time to dance. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, he becomes a weird Jamaican guy.
Yeah.
There were like butterflies or something flying off his shirt. And
Yeah.
Was weird.
Yeah, and then like the monkey kisses him and stuff too, but it's shot in a way where obviously the monkey was nowhere near Michael Bailey Smith. There's just kind of like reaction of like kiss me, one piece, one love, plenty of banana, Irimon. I'm like, Jesus Christ, okay.
But Steve, it's not racist.
We can trim this out.
Chimpanzee.
Okay, you say so.
He's a chimp. He's from Africa. He knows.
There you go. Well,
I don't know.
I remember another thing about the them talking about like, oh no, he can't use the laser drill because his whole plan's to like do it down a volcano to get to the Earth's core and unleash the ultimate power. I think she puts it exactly like that. I'm like, The core? What? No?
Yeah, I don't know.
Is it going to stop the Earth? I don't know. But then she's like, but no, obviously if it goes wrong, they could just blow up Japan and therefore the world. And so she's like, all right, I'll help you. I'll help save the world. Meanwhile, the circus people are sent on an operation, Operation Road Trip or something like that. Because they're sent to Dr. Farley's mansion to, I don't know, get information?
Fuck around and find out?
So yeah, they start driving for that. Meanwhile, back in Japan, Amelia, she's like, I'd really like to talk to my dad. I haven't seen him in a couple days. They're like, oh yeah, let me get him on the call. One moment. And we get another deep fake dad call. And she's like, I don't know. I kind of wish you were here. And like, well, suck it up, Buttercup. Like, that doesn't sound like my dad. I don't know. She starts getting a little wary at this point. I don't know. It's dumb. But so we're at Dr. Farley's house in Montana. And I'm like, Montana? Really? All right. Here we go. It kind of looks like the high atop the Mulholland View shelf there in Los Angeles, but I don't know, it could be anywhere. And I don't know, they have like the muscle guy like pull down the gate, and I'm like, well, that sets off the alarms right there, but don't worry. Then we have a Quicksilver guy, or Lightning, whatever the fuck his name is, running around. I don't know, they start launching people, like use a teeter-totter to launch them up to the second floor so they can get in. Hijinks ensue. Basically, Fantastic Four stuff.
They Fantastic Four it. I don't appreciate that the girl's in like a weird fat suit.
It's because they have to make her round.
I don't know.
Yeah, so she can roll down the stairs and take out guys. But yeah, they find the plans for the laser drill, and I think they even find that it's like, oh yeah, it's what was the name of the mountain? I got it written down here. Oh yeah, Mount Yurigataki or something like oh, it's this volcano in Japan we got to go to. Blah blah blah. Cool, thanks for the plans. Great. And they end up having to like take out security. Like I said, rolling down the stairs, taking them out. So then we cut to morning, and I don't know. When we cut to morning, we're at the hotel that the dad, Dr. Moore, and the monkey are staying at in Japan, because you know they just kind of hopped over there real quick in a couple of hours. And the humans are sleeping on the couch. And I guess Minky's in the bed? And I'm like, I don't know about that.
Right?
I mean, I get being nice for your pets and all, but no, guys. Don't do that. Oh, I know what it is. It was socially awkward for, you know, I know we just met a couple hours ago on the beach in Jamaica or whatever. We probably shouldn't share a bed. And, you know, Japan doesn't believe in having multiple rooms in a hotel room, or multiple beds in a hotel room.
I mean, when we stayed our traditional ryokan, we didn't even have like a Western style bed.
No,
yeah. We just had the futon on the floor.
Yeah, we just had a goddamn feather topper, basically.
Yeah, it's a Japanese style futon.
Yeah, well, there you go.
It was very comfortable. I will give
it was surprisingly comfortable. It's always amazing with you.
It was also about 2 feet too short for Steve. So
his everything in Japan was 2 feet too short for Steve.
Except for the subway and the trains. They were shockingly tall.
Oh, yes. Yeah, I could definitely stand up where the luggage was supposed to go.
Yeah, but at least they were that tall versus on Bart.
Yeah.
You had to cock your head to one side just to stand up.
See what we can have? We can be decent people, everybody. Anyway, Japan has it down. Take notes. What? They don't have to fund their own war machine because the U.S. takes care of that? Okay.
What?
Ugh. Steve, get off that soapbox. Sorry. So yeah, what happens? Yeah, so then Minky, I don't know, he grabs some, like, box or whatever as they're, like, leaving or whatever. I'm like, what the fuck is that? Blah, blah, blah. And then he, like, throws it down. It turns into a skateboard.
Yeah.
They're like, all right, cool.
Ba-da-ba-da.
So he goes skating off, and Hugo's chasing behind him on a motorcycle, and they're just going through, you know, downtown Tokyo or whatever, no big deal. And then of course, because he's on a skateboard, that means we have to go to a skate park, and we see, you know, a monkey on a skateboard rolling all
most
over
extreme primate.
And then okay, we get out of the skate park and we're like going through a park or something, and long story short, that's right, what's his nuts? Hugo is like on a motorcycle and he goes in the skate park, but you know, he's going too fast or not cool enough or whatever. I don't know. He launches out of there and he lands in about 6 inches of water after doing like a 10-foot jump on a motorcycle. And I'm like, oh, that stuntman is down.
Oh yeah. That guy, like, the bike on its side sticks out of the water.
Yeah. Yeah, it looked jarring. But, you know, they cut it right, and it's like, oh man, ooh, he's knocked out. Good for him. So then, after this, Hugo gets up, and he, like, takes a taxi, I think they, like, follow him or whatever to, like, find out where this Pyramid Entertainment is. You know, the building they're keeping him in, even though they should know he's part of Pyramid Enterprises or whatever, and whatever. But then, Amelia and Dr. Farley goes down to like where he's keeping Amelia, and he's like, hey, guess what? We're going on a road trip. Let's get to the chopper. Okay, but when's my dad coming? Like, oh yeah, he'll meet us there. It's going to be great. That's like stupid shit like that. And, oh, that's right. No, what it is, Hugo gets in the taxi, and then Minky grabs like the back of the taxi, and he's on the skateboard still.
Yes.
And, like, that's right. He Back to the Future's that shit all the way to the building. And that's right. But the dad ends up there too, so they must have known that's where the end location was going to be or whatever. Anyway, like they knew that's where Dr. Farley was because he fucking knocks out that caterer and steals his clothes.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm like, oh man, he's like fucking around there. But yeah, they all get in and they're like, you know, there's like a good 5 minutes or whatever where they're like sneaking around trying to find where everything is. But Minky knows, fuck that, I gotta go straight to the roof, and he holds on to the bottom of the chopper as it's taken off.
Get to the chopper.
Yeah, I don't know, like, Edith is, like, tracking it, too. I think Minky has, like, a tracking device, like, on his wristwatch or some shit like that, and...
Or was Edith just, because I know she, like, was in, like, radio contact, was she just telling him?
Yeah, I think she was telling him, like, oh, yeah, they're heading to Mount... Oh no, that's right. I think it was around this time she was getting the info from the files or whatever. They're like,
yeah.
Oh yeah, it's all going down at Mount Yurigataki. Okay, cool. So we cut to Mount Yurigataki and we're at the base camp that the bad guys have set up there. And I don't know, we see like the chopper flying in and Minky like drops off before they get to the base or whatever. But then at the base they're like, hey, it looked like you had a passenger drop off right before you got it within the perimeter, and like it shows Minky falling off or whatever. And they're like, all right, put the guards on alert, blah, blah, blah. And we see Minky like coming out of the snow because he had like, you know, he fell from a chopper or whatever, so he got 10 feet deep into the snow or whatever, was just crawling out. And then Babe, who shows up?
That's right, Mr. Miyagi shows up.
That's right.
I was like, all the guys dressed in white. That's right, Mr. Miyagi shows up!
Mr. Miyagi in, like, a white ninja outfit. And he's basically like, come with me, my friend. We got to get you out of here.
Yeah, secret snow ninjas!
That's right. So they get out of there just before, like, the guys on, like, snowmobiles or whatever pull up.
And, you know,
like,
they're the good guys because they're dressed in white. And the bad guys are dressed in black.
Yeah, exactly. So you get it. So then we cut to, I don't know, the random ninja camp in the middle of Mount Yurigataki or whatever it is. And we get Mr. Miyagi basically expositioning like, we know why you are here. You are here to save Japan. We must not let this laser drill destroy. But I'm like, what the how does he know all this shit? Oh, because he's a ninja. I get it. And this where you and I both made the joke. Just like the gypsy woman said.
Just like the gypsy woman said.
As foretold in the prophecy. Misan al-Gaib.
This is also where I made the realization that that's the summary for Dune. Just like the gypsy woman said.
Just like the gypsy woman said. Misan al-Gaib.
No!
And yeah, around this time, Amelia finally figures it out. They're like, hey, so... I don't know, she does, like, some stupid trick, and she's like, yeah, I know that's not what's happening here. I want to talk to my dad, my real dad, not my deepfake dad that you've been... Oh, that's right, I think she, like, stumbles upon the studio or whatever.
Oh, no, no, or... she's like, hey, can I call my dad? Because she's, like, getting suspicious.
Yeah.
And, yeah, he's like, yeah, sure, of course. And then it's like, hi, honey, Because there's a whole thing earlier about how her and her dead mom loved burnt toast.
Yeah.
And so he's just like, she's just like, Dad, I really miss you. Yeah, honey, and as soon as you finish this project, you can come home. But Dad, I'm really tired and I really miss you. Well, just suck it up, Buttercup.
Yeah.
And fucking do it.
Yeah.
And like, hey, Dad, sorry about the burnt toast the other day. Oh, that's okay, sweetie. Nobody likes burnt toast. That's and like she turns it off, and I swear to God, was just like that motherfucker.
By the way, I know I brought up the dad is played by the guy from Pacifier.
Yeah,
that basically makes a couple cameos in that movie. Why isn't Eric Roberts the dad?
Because he's more fun as bad guy.
Because Eric Roberts can't see himself being partnered with an ape in flashback scenes.
He thinks he's too good for it.
I mean, probably.
He's and busy to be doing, fair,
he's right.
He's busy doing cat voices.
That's right. He's too busy. I don't know. Can I record my voice from home? Pass.
He was supposed to be the voice of the ape, but unfortunately, version just didn't work out.
He was going to be the Amon, one piece, one love. What the fuck is this?
Unfortunately, they were afraid that a Eric Roberts talking ape would give Steve too much of a hard on.
That's right.
The world is not prepared for that.
You know what? They're right to do so.
They were protecting us all, honey. Yeah. An erection lasting more than 4 hours needs to be addressed by a medical professional.
It's true. So yeah, what happens? Oh yeah, Dad and Dr. Amore show up and are immediately caught.
Oh, immediately. World's best...
Well,
spy.
He to be fair, he is without his partner and instead with a hot lady doctor. So. Oh,
not the hot lady doctor.
Right. It's kryptonite to spies, I tell you.
It's called the honeypot, babe.
Whether her name's Dr. Moore or Dr. Christmas Jones.
Yeah. I heard Christmas only comes once a year.
Ah! Okay. So yeah, what happens from here? Oh yeah, fucking ninjas.
Fucking ninjas, man!
Ninjas show up and, they like save the dad and Dr. Amore or whatever. Or wait. Is that what happens?
They free them and then are like, the dad's like, I'm gonna go in through the ducts. Dr. Amore, you go with the ninjas and you guys go around the back. We're gonna find my daughter. As soon as she's safe, we can attack.
There we go. Well, that's right. And then, Minky and, Minky and someone else fight at this point. Who the fuck was it? I have M&M.
Oh, Minky has something in his pocket, and they look like M&Ms. He throws them on the ground, and they do the slip and fall thing.
I gotta take better notes. Anyway, yeah, there's a whole fight scene with the ninjas and shit. I have written down where there is a scene where the guy gets like kicked in the nuts 5 times in a row. But I'm like, but if it's a chimp's foot, is it being slapped in the nuts 5 times? Like a spinning back slap? I don't know. But anyway, it happens. I'm trying to think of it, because then randomly, like, a stealth fighter comes flying by and drops off supplies for Minky. I'm not sure exactly. I guess Edith must have sent him or something like that.
Yes.
Send the coordinates? I don't know. But, okay, then, whatever. Oh, yeah, around this time, deepfake dad call, blah, blah, blah. All right, whatever. Yeah, she finds this. Yeah, Emma Roberts finds this. Blah, 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 blah. Oh, that's right. Okay, then they're sneak. That's right. The dad, Dr. Amore, like some of the ninjas stuff, they're like sneaking around. And we see the guards watching the sumo wrestling.
Yeah!
And I'm like, fuck yeah, dude. And. Oh, that's right. Minky's. He's still on the outside because they haven't gotten the perimeter yet. Okay, so the ninjas fight like the snowmobile guys or whatever.
Okay,
that's where that whole fight was going next. He's still on the outside because he gets to the fence and then he's like trying to like snip it, but it's electrified.
Okay,
and it's like zap. Roll credits, guys. What do we think? Da-da-da-da. Yeah, but the zapping the fence or whatever like sets off the alarm. Or no, I guess the dad must have done it, because that's right. They get recaptured again, and I'm like,
oh, that's right.
You guys got captured like twice in 5 minutes. What the fuck? Oh, okay. Yeah, that's right. The snowmobile guys get the dad and the doctor like in the forest, and that's when the ninjas like pop up out of nowhere and save them, and then they go attack the base, and then they get caught immediately after that. That's what it was. All right, guys. It's been 3 or 4 days since we've seen the movie.
Yeah.
And we're going off spotty notes, so
what?
Yeah, I know. That's what we do. But Steve will fix it in post.
What?
Steve cut that part out. Anyway. And then, yeah, that's right. We cut back to, like, the dojo, and Minky's there with, Oh, that's right. It was Minky and Miyagi that was fighting, and Miyagi got kicked 5 times in the nuts. That's what it was.
Okay.
Yeah, okay. It's all making sense now. Because, yeah, then we cut back to, and they're, like, doing meditation or whatever at the ninja dojo. And Minky's, like, getting up and going, like, all right, we attack at sunrise, but you must go alone. And I'm like, why? Oh, because, you know, if it's only one person, they'll never see it coming. But if it's a whole swarm of ninjas, and I'm like, isn't the point of ninjas not being caught?
Ninjas don't get caught. That's, yeah.
Anyway, so they take the cave passage up to the north face and blah, blah, blah. We see a monkey doing a cliffhanger, like, you know, climbing up the face of a mountain and all that. Well, even says something like, they'll never expect it from there because only a fool would take that path. And I'm like, yeah, you got a point. Yeah, I don't know. We get to Amelia and Dr. Farley. They get to, like, the volcano where there's, like, these... It's basically like hologram doors. Like, it's hologram to, like, look like the side of a mountain, but they just keep walking through it, and it's into this base. And this is where the full-size drill is, like the drill base, I guess. And, yeah, this is where, you know, Emma Roberts, what's her name? Amelia, she's like, no, I want to talk to my real dad. I know you're full of shit. What's going on? Blah, blah, blah. And he's like, all right, fine. Let's talk to your real dad. Oh, look, he's over here tied up with Dr. Amore, too. Do what I say or I fucking kill him, kind of a thing. But, you know, the PG version. And, I don't know, we see Minky, he uses the x-ray goggles to, like, see the base. And, yeah, Dr. Farley, he's giving this whole explanation. Like, all right, we got it built full size, but we've been having some issues and we need you to fix it. Otherwise, we have to kill your dad or whatever. And, I don't know, Amelia immediately is like, oh, it's because of, like, blowback or whatever she says at the beginning of the movie. But it's like, I used to use a hair scrunchie or whatever to...
Yeah, this is. I used to use this hair tie to keep the vibrations down. All right, we need to measure the elasticity of this exact hair tie and amplify it by 100 times.
Yeah. Yep. Fantastic stuff. And so they start fixing it. I don't know. There's like a snowball fight at some point with Minky and all that. They're like sneaking in. All right, and now they're doing the drill test. And so they got the laser going, and they're like, all right, 10 minutes till we reach the Earth's core. And I'm like, all right, cool. We got the ticking clock. The movie's almost over. Here we go. And basically, Farley tells Hugo, like, hey, take the dad and Dr. Amore and, you know, get rid of them.
Okay, boss.
But wouldn't you know it, Minky in his goddamn ninja outfit shows up and starts whooping some ass. And then, he ended up, like, choking out Hugo or whatever, like, with his bare hands or whatever. Or ape hands, I guess, but...
I thought Hugo... Oh, is Hugo the one who slips on the ball bearings and knocks himself unconscious?
Yeah, there's a couple... Yeah, he fell on his back, and then Minky, like, jumped on and started, like, choking him or whatever.
Yeah, I don't know. They cut away from that pretty quick.
Yeah.
Either way, Hugo's knocked out. He's dreaming about a Jamaican gorilla. Yeah,
exactly. But then there's, like, the place starts rumbling... Oh no, the drill must be, I don't know, doing drill shit.
Oh, and, the drill is drilling!
And then they're like, well, how are we going to get into the base? And Dr. Moore's like, I wonder if they took my access codes out. And she basically goes, all, beep, boop, beep, boop, beep, blink. Yep, I guess we can just get right in here. And so she goes in, and Dr. Farley's like, wait, what are you doing here? You're supposed to be killed! And she's like, oh no, I got away. I've always wanted to be a part of this plan. I just didn't believe you had the balls to get it done.
Oh, but now that I know you do, I'm... Oh, I never want to leave you. Yeah. I want to be by your side.
And then that's when Dad and Minky jump in and start kicking some ass. And they stop the drill. And then more ninjas pop out of the fucking skies and they start helping. And, I don't know, we get a bunch of fucking, like, flip kicks and, you know, all sorts of shit. That's right, flip kicks and cattle prods for the next, like, 10 minutes. Because, like, all the guards have... little cattle prod thing, so they got, like, turned on, like, and yet, basically, I guess they set the drill to explode, and it's like, okay, I guess that's one way to do it.
Yeah.
Babe, why can't they just turn it off?
It doesn't have an off button, it only has a self-destruct button.
Exactly.
But the first, they have to reverse it, and they have to make it overheat, So it has to suck the laser back into itself or something.
Yes. I love like 30 seconds until it reaches the core, and then it's like, okay, turned off it. Like, you just see the laser, like, go backwards slowly.
Yeah, but there's not a hole or anything.
Yeah, it's fucking dumb. But they're like, wait, this thing's gonna blow? Run! Everybody starts running out of there. And they go out the hologram doors. Everybody's hopping on, like, snowboards and snowmobiles. And, yeah, I don't know. Yeah, that's right. Hugo's still alive. He hops on a snowboard and is chasing him. And, yeah, the drill, like, explodes, like, 1 second before the core is breached or whatever. And I'm like, that core is breached, my that, friend.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
At the very least, that volcano is going to, like, fucking go off, like, nobody's right. business. But whatever. It's a stupid laser in a kid's movie. But guys, the drill exploded.
Oh!
So that causes an avalanche. Oh!
Avalanche! And now they have to most extreme snowboard down the mountain.
Yeah! And yeah, that avalanche, is right, Hugo's like behind him, but then I think it was Amelia, somebody pulls out that electro paintball gun and hits Hugo,
yeah.
So he gets shocked, and then the avalanche buries him alive, roll credits on
oh,
him.
Oh yeah, that's how you murder a villain in a kid's movie.
Yep.
Literally cold-blooded.
And then like, oh no, the avalanche is still coming, but there's just this cliff! Oh, they had a parachute the whole time!
Oh, yeah. Emma, like, rides right off, and Minky,
like, on her back,
like,
yeah.
Leaps onto her back and has the parachute, and...
Yeah.
And it they're goes, totally in the same scene.
Yeah, it's... Guys, I don't compare monkey movies to, oh my god, Die Another Day. Die Another Day, the whole snowboarding scene or whatever with
the CG's better
shelving.
In this.
I mean, maybe. I think, God, they might have even come out like within a year of each other or something.
I mean, maybe.
But yeah, so they fly off to safety. Yay! And then, yeah, they end up calling Edith and are like, hey, we're coming home. Oh, kisses all around. Everybody's happy. And Miyagi's like, well, I must go back to my snow ninjas. Thanks, buddy. High five. You know, all that shit. And then ring, ring. Babe, who is it?
The president.
That's right. The motherfucking president, Barry Bostwick. And he's like, hey, guys, congratulations on a job well done. How would you guys like to be spies again? Thanks. Roll credits.
Oh, no. We got the Emma like, wow, you really were a spy with a monkey
partner. Oh, yeah, that's right. Oh, yeah, you weren't full of shit, Dad.
I'm going to have some more burnt toast.
Roll credits. Guys, that's Spymate. Babe, would you recommend this movie?
Oh, 100%. This movie's amazing.
Now, it was about the time Miyagi showed up with his ninjas.
Right.
And I was like, is this the greatest movie ever made? I mean, it's an ape spy movie with a DeLorean and a laser drilled at the core.
Yeah.
Now, guys, look, as far as these, like, Air Bud, the Air Bud universe or whatever.
Yep.
This one was actually a lot of fun. I enjoyed it. And it's a tight 80 minutes or whatever, too. It has Friends of the Podcast starring in it.
Yeah.
It has future Friends of the Podcast starring in it.
Steve, I hate to tell you this. Mr. Miyagi's not much of a draw anymore.
Barry Bostwick's still around, though. I believe Emma Roberts is still around at the time of this recording.
Last we checked.
Debra Jo Rupp, she's... Anyway. But, Yeah, check it out. It's on YouTube, for God's sakes. Like,
this is easy to find. This is, yeah. Go watch this.
Yeah. Well, on that note, we're going to take a quick commercial break. Oh, baby.
Steve.
When we come back,
yeah,
we have more beer.
What?
Fun facts. And what we learn from Spymate.
Yeah.
Hey everybody, are you looking for the perfect stocking stuffer for the holidays? Do you like supporting the arts? Well then you need to check out untidyvenus.etsy.com, the top one-stop shop that always pops her top. Are you a fan of dinosaurs, snacks, dinosaurs made out of snacks, movie monsters, unicorns, cats, dogs, rats, shrimp, Pokemon, tie-dye, paracord bracelets, paracord dog leashes, enamel pins, coloring books, block prints, watercolor, pet portraits?
buttons, magnets, stickers, bottle openers, artist trading cards, or really anything else that's awesome? Then stop on by untidyvenus.etsy.com. That's a goddess who's bad at housekeeping. .etsy.com. New items are popping up all the time, so be sure to follow her on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, or Patreon at untidyvenus. Or visit her website at izzycreates.com for the latest. Did I mention the Snackosaurs? How about Gary the Unicorns? UntidyVenus.etsy.com, the goddess who's bad at housekeeping. Check it out now.
When the world is in danger.
Sea levels have been rising steadily, leading to economic collapse.
When the threat is beyond belief.
Zorn is back from the dead.
We never did find his body in San Francisco Bay all those years ago. I told you these microchips will be huge. Now I have to flood the world. Flood the microchip market? No, the world! Like that water movie with the fish man.
There's only one man who can save us.
Bond. James Bond.
I've developed a lot of gadgets over the years, 007, but a time machine simply isn't one of them.
You're not the man you once were, Bond. Time knows no mercy.
Didn't you die a few movies ago?
Obviously, that's completely irrelevant.
But when that one man reaches a certain age, he could probably use some help.
Don't worry. I've arranged a meeting with an old friend of mine. Wait, you're not Anya Amasova?
No, but I am Agent Triple X. Now, two cultural icons must work together to bring down evil.
Mr. Bond, Mr. Cage, you see, it's already too late. Project Final Strike is already underway.
Yeah? Well, I live for this
language. Do you want a PG-13 rating or not?
There you go with your old man MPAA regulations.
Old man? Gentlemen,
you're literally 8 months older
guys,
than I am.
Look it up. I'm over here divulging my evil plan.
But will they be able to even get along? Yeah? Well, you know about extreme sports.
Well, since you asked, I'm an Olympic-level skier and marksman. I've raced speedboats, jet skis, snowmobiles, sports cars with missiles on them, all while people were shooting at me. Let's see, I've motorbiked through bazaars, taught Jason Bourne how to parkour, windsurfed a tsunami, basically invented your precious snowboarding while listening to Beach Boys, and I still hold the record for the highest bungee jump in human history. So kindly show me some goddamn respect.
Oh yeah? Well, I get a lot of ladies, too.
Child, please. I secured more confirmed strange and a view to a kill than you have your entire franchise. Now, if you'll excuse me, I have this bomb to design.
I just don't think I should be alone tonight.
I'll watch her.
You will.
No, I'm watching her.
Well, who do you think?
But I'm more qualified.
Poof a monkey dishwasher.
Jinx, you owe me a Coke. Damn it!
Hello, James.
Mayday. I thought you...
died in an explosion? No, I'm a genetically altered superhuman, like Wolverine or Captain America.
Are those secret agents?
Are you kidding me?
I'm Groot.
See? He gets it!
James Bond and Xander Cage to return in No Hope for Sequel. Coming this fall on your favorite podcatcher.
Hi, this is Johnny C. McGinley, and you're listening to Everything I Learned from Movies. All the best.
And we're back!
Oh my god, Steve, those are the greatest ads that ever added in the history of adding.
Oh, she said it!
Monkey. They are carnivores.
Monkey! Monkoy!
Oh, that's right, Monkoy.
Oh shit, if, Gary Daniels or whatever? Yes! Gary Daniels is the dad, been fucking great.
Yeah?
You believe I was a spy with a Monkoy?
No, Dad, I really don't.
We ate meat together. It was great. Bloody Dad? Hell. Anyway.
Dad, please just stop lying to me.
Well, babe, I don't know about you. I'm a little thirsty.
Ooh, I'm still sober.
Oh, let's change that. From Great Basin Brewery in Reno, Nevada, we have their Outlaw Milk Stout.
Yeah!
5% alcohol by volume.
That's all?
That's it, yeah.
All right.
Yeah, it's a milk stout. It's not like an imperial or anything. And you guys may be wondering, milk and a beer? Gross. Babe, tell them about milk stouts.
Milk stouts don't actually have full milk. They just have the lactose. You know, the thing that makes everybody sick.
Mm-hmm.
The ingestible sugary stuff. But it ferments and creates this great luscious mouth feel.
It doesn't ferment. That's why...
No, lactose can ferment.
I thought that...
Lactose is fermentable.
I thought that's why you use lactose, because it's one of the sugars that doesn't ferment, and that's what, that's what makes it like a sweeter stout. Is that not the case?
Let's Google it.
We're Googling it, guys, because we want to make sure we're not spreading bullshit.
Brews you lactose to add sweetness and thicken the mouthfeel because it's a sugar the brewing yeast can't ferment. I am wrong. Hey. My apologies.
No worries. No, I like... It would also make sense, like, even if it does, but it's, like, a lot slower or whatever, longer breakdown keeps it sweet.
Yeah, unlike honey, which it, like, just yeast ferments like that.
Yeah, exactly. Just leaves behind the bee poop.
Yeah.
That's that earthiness, guys. It's great. And, anyway, my top.
Oh! His top.
Nice. And le pour.
Oh, yeah. This is a beautiful dark brown beer. It has a gorgeous khaki-colored head. Lots of medium to fine bubbles that seem to be lingering, all right?
Fine bubbles makes me happy. Yeah, malt forward, very very sweet on the aroma.
Like. Yeah, very like milk chocolate on the aroma.
Yeah, taking a sip, yeah, it's definitely almost like a milk chocolate, like very...
Yeah.
Like a little bit of bitterness. It was like bittersweet chocolate, but not like 80% cacao or anything. No, yeah. This is like Hershey. Like Hershey with a little bit of a little spice on top or something. I don't know. Just a little pepperiness to it.
Yeah, definitely. Like it has a dry finish, and I think we should drink these quickly because I feel like there's just a tiny little bit of funk on the back end.
I mean, yeah.
Are you getting that?
Yeah, there's a little, yeah, I mean...
Just a little something on the back end. Like
coffee notes or something, but yeah,
there's it might be a little... coffee note, but I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know, maybe I'm just getting the sweetness a lot. But, yeah, guys, milk stouts, I'd say definitely try them. You may not want to do, like, 3 pints in a row or whatever.
Ask me how
the thing is, like, with that much lactose or whatever, it's like, even if you're not intolerant or whatever of it, it builds up quickly.
It will make you sensitive.
Yeah.
Mm-mm. Mm-hmm.
That's Outlaw Milk Stout from Great Basin Brewing in Reno, Nevada.
Reno, Nevada.
Well, babe, would you be interested in any fun facts about this movie?
I don't know, Steve, are they? Fun facts, super fun facts, because of fun facts.
Well, let's find out. Babe, Rotten Tomatoes, what do you think the critics thought of Spymate?
Do the critics think of Spymate?
They do.
I think they're not going to get it. I'm going to go with my super generous 17%.
Babe, it is exactly 17% with the critics. There was one positive review out of the 6. And that's from Susan Walker of the Toronto Star. Quote, "It's a half-baked movie that looks strangely dated. It was actually made in 2003 and released in 2006. So a fun fact there. Underfinanced and simplistic next to films with the same theme, like the Spy Kids series." That was the one positive review.
Alrighty.
But babe, there's also an audience score. What do you think the audience score is for this movie?
Oh, I think this is going to be 55%.
55? It is 39%. So a little lower, but yeah, maybe. I don't know. As far as like kids action movies and stuff go, not bad.
No, not at all. They're much worse. In fact, I'm going to go ahead and say the first writer on this makes majority of the worst kids movies.
Look, I got an ape or a golden retriever. Which one's starring in this one?
Dude, you guys, avoid the fucking buddy movies. The buddy movies are awful. They're just awful.
Coming next week? No.
All right, Space Buddies. It does have a monkey in it.
Does it have a monkey?
God. I've seen it.
No! What have I done? Babe, Steve, what do you think? I don't have the budget for this movie.
Okay.
What do you think the worldwide gross is? Spoilers, it's also the U.S. gross.
Oh, it wasn't released internationally. Huh? Oh, so the international audience? Or that guy in England who kept downloading every episode of our podcast for like 2 years straight isn't going to be able to watch it?
I mean, not in theaters, I guess.
I'm going to say 176,000.
Close. $46,007.
Oh, I was very generous.
You're right. Emma Roberts spent several weeks on set teaching Louis sign language. So, inky.
Louis sign?
Louis sign? And this is also Brittany Wilson's debut as Jules. Who the fuck was Jules?
Is that the circus girl?
Maybe. Brittany N.E.Y. Wilson.
Oh, her friend from high school.
Oh, yeah, they like walk to school or whatever, like at the beginning. Okay. But this is her debut, but she has 70 plus credits, babe.
Okay.
And little things like Chasing Christmas. She's also Whistle Wishes Breezy Bee in My Little Pony, The Runaway Rainbow. She's the star of 15 episodes of Dino Sapien. What's that, Steve?
Dino Sapien.
Something I found out because of looking this up. A girl befriends a dino at camp. We might have to find this.
We have to find this.
She's also in 5 episodes of Bates Motel, 6 episodes of Rogue. She plays older Candace Cameron in the unauthorized Full House story. She is also Sweetie Pom Pom in 11 episodes of Littlest Pet Shop, colon, A World of Our Own. And now she's
their
also
colon
in...
colon is their world of their own.
Yeah! And she's also in about a dozen of those Hallmark Christmas movies.
Okay.
So just stuff we haven't seen, but, you know, a pretty good career base.
Somebody listening to this is like, oh my god, she's my favorite! Fuck you guys!
Let's see if Dino Sapien's on Tubi. Please hold, everybody. See if you edit this out. Yeah, don't worry about it.
Excuse me.
Dino Sapien, television program.
It's on Pluto, Freevee, Philo, and Sling.
Is it?
According to this. Oh, no, never mind. It auto-corrected to Dinotopia.
Oh, yeah, Dinotopia's everywhere, but... Yeah, 2007 apparently was a BBC show.
It's on YouTube.
All right, well, that works for me. Oh, yeah, episode 1, 21 minutes, Dawn of the Dinosaur. Here we go. Guys, coming this Dinovember, Dino Sapien.
The dinosaur.
Open the door, get on that floor.
Ooh, check it like a boom boom.
Well, babe, we've reached the most important part. What did we learn from Spymate?
I learned Mr. Miyagi's not dead. He just lives in the mountains of Japan with his underground snow ninjas.
You know, I want to believe that. I really do.
This is what I believe. Oh, and that some people enjoy burnt toast.
Ugh. Monsters, I tell you.
Fucking monsters.
I learned there's no off switch, only a self-destruct.
Ah, yes.
Yep. And, I don't know. Combined with, I don't know, starting off with Lawrence of ArAPEia and hopping in a DeLorean and, I don't know, ninjas popping up in the third act of the volcano lair. This may be the greatest movie ever made.
I mean...
Greatest spy movie ever made.
Steve?
Move over, Casino Royale 67. You've got a new...
Steve, movies you've watched for the first time this year. Dune Part 2 or Spymate?
Ooh, don't make me choose. Dune Part 2. Mostly because of the implied incest. No, I don't.
Okay.
No, I... Because that one has Christopher Walken.
Anyway. Now, is there a movie with Christopher Walken and apes? What December are we doing?
No, babe. There's a movie where Christopher Walken is an ape.
What?
Do you remember the Jungle? The Disney's The
Jungle
Book?
Oh, goddamn it.
Where he's King Louie?
Oh, goddamn it.
We saw that in theaters, babe. How could you forget?
Oh, goddamn it. I was trying to
be like you. Ooh, ooh.
I mean, technically.
And then he dances around?
Technically, in Batman Returns, there's the circus monkey, the little organ grinder monkey.
Oh, yeah, a little Spike from Ace Ventura. Yeah. Look, Spike!
I mean, technically.
Yeah, yeah. Christopher Walken movie month.
I was about to say, what December are we going to do walking in a winter wonderland?
Babe, you know what movies we got to do when it rolls around. We're definitely doing a... Oh, my God. The alien possession movie.
Oh!
Come come something.
Communion.
Communion. Yes. That's it.
Communion.
I was like, commute? No, that's not it. Communion.
That was another one I was surprised you'd never seen. Because I feel like that was on Sci-Fi Channel, like, all the time.
I had never seen the full thing. I had only seen the 10 minutes, or 5 minutes worth watching.
Okay.
The rest of it, I didn't know he was, like, based on a true story. The guy was an asshole actor. Guys, coming soon, Communion. you know what, baby? Maybe this December is walking in a winter.
Walking in a winter wonderland.
Well, babe, in the meantime, thanks for watching Spymate with me.
Thank you for watching it with me.
And are you on social media at all?
Sort of. You can occasionally catch me over at Untidy Venus. It's a goddess who's bad at housekeeping. I'm on all the social medias and the Patreons and now the Blue Skis at Untidy Venus. Steve, yes. Where can we find you?
Everywhere! Oh. We're on all the major podcatchers and everything I learned from movies. Or hit us up directly on Twitter, Facebook, Patreon, and Blueski at EILF Movies. That's everything I learned from movies. Guys, we're getting close to being done with April here. Oh, then we get back into some random stuff with May. Oh, then we got some good things coming up in the summer. But you can find out more about that if you're on our Patreon at EILF Movies. Or, you know, just pay attention.
Yeah, pretty much.
Do we want your money? Sure, that'd be nice. If not, meh.
Tune in.
We understand. Times are tough.
We get it.
You got to pay for Paramount Plus or whatever to watch all the 15 Star Trek series that are going on and stuff like that. We understand.
I'm glad we didn't get that devoted.
Nah.
No, we're much more to the Renegade is what we're watching currently, guys.
Guys, we are watching Renegade, and holy shit, that show is great. Why isn't Branscombe Richmond a thing?
Why is he not more of a thing? He is amazing.
Lorenzo Lamas had a career. Why not Branscombe?
Okay, I want a TV show where we have Anthony DeLongis and Branscombe together. It's like a buddy cop.
Yeah. He's a Native American businessman.
Yeah.
He's a whipmaster and horseback riding complete badass.
Swordsmith.
The only thing is, babe, both of those gentlemen are well into their 60s, possibly 70s.
And I bet they could still both kick my ass at any given time.
True, but, you know, they're going up against...
I mean, Grant's had a tough day at Costco, kicks my ass, but...
dude, it really does. You're like, wife going to the Valley Market and back.
Have you seen the way the tourists from Texas park down there? Jesus Christ. I didn't think you could take like 11 parking spots with one truck.
It's almost as bad as the locals. High five. So yeah, I guess until next time, I'm Steve.
And I'm Izzy.
And this is Everything I Learned from Movies. Have a good night, everybody.
Bye, everybody. I haven't seen that guy who kept insulting my car in a while.
Oh, he's dead, babe.
Right? The guy in the big F-150 was just like, your car sucks. Your truck's named after a big poo. Bye.
No.
Oh. Hey, Sleeping Beauty. Wake up, man.
Huh?
It's time to get down to the rhythm of the islands. Got no chance, cause this gym can't start. I call this one the cha-cha chimpanzee. Back and forth, move the hand, move the hand, move the hand. Body, 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 shake the little chimp people. One piece, one love, and plenty banana.